You're here listening to Green Left, and where my name is Jacob Andrewartha. I'm based in Wandering Land in Melbourne, and I'm with Green Left. And for our podcast today, we're very happy to be joined by three activists based in the United States who have been involved in what is really an inspiring development in the Free Palestine movement. Because within the Free Palestine movement in the United States, we are seeing student encampments and other forms of kind of disruptive protests starting to erupt in the United States. And it's also serving as a massive inspiration to activists, Palestine activists all around, solidarity activists all around the world, including the fact that there's already been encampments set up in University of Melbourne, which is my university. And of course Isaac, who's here, who will introduce himself, who's from who who's based in Gadigal land, where an encampment has been set up in the University of Sydney.
Yeah, there's the encampment set up on the April 22nd here in Gadigal, Sydney, and it's popping up. I think there's six universities now in Australia that have encampments set up, and that's like out of hundreds that are happening around the world and in the US. I think it's on every continent. So we're excited to talk about kind of the current situation over in the US. We're here with three student activists. If you'd like to introduce yourselves, we'll start with Cyn, and then you guys can all just jump in and let us know which campuses you're currently at and how you're involved in the encampments over there.
Yeah, hey everyone. Thanks so much for having us. First of all, big fan of the publication and just this experience of exchanging lessons and experiences is super valuable. So thanks so much for inviting us. Yeah, a little bit about myself. I'm a student at UC Berkeley, a graduating senior. Hopefully that'll go smoothly. A student labor and socialist activist. I was the former national co-chair of YDSA, I believe, between 21 and 22. I'm a member of UAW Local 4811. So this is a higher education academic local of the United Auto Workers. I built it in various capacities as a rank and file member, as a head steward, an elected leader, and also as a paid organizing staff. And I'm also a participant in Berkeley's Solidarity Encampment.
Awesome. Did you want to jump in, Daniel?
Sure, of course. Thank you so much. So excited to be here. Thank you so much for having us. My name is Daniel. I am a student in New York City. I am a senior at Hunter College studying history. Hunter College is a public university within the CUNY system, which what like our encampment has often been referred to. It's a network of different campuses, different universities in New York, particularly in the city. I'm also a member of YDSA. I've been organizing on my campus as a student organizer and a socialist organizer for the past like 3 or 4 years, mostly against austerity. Within like I was a leader of my YDSA chapter at Hunter College, and currently I'm a member of YDSA subsection of our international committee, doing a bunch of like internationalist work, international solidarity work. But obviously past week has everything has been put on pause as we've kind of threw ourselves into this moment and into this movement for Palestine and on our campuses. And I've participated a helped build the CUNY Gaza Solidarity Encampment, which had happened on the quad of the City College, which is different campus from where I attend, just a couple blocks up in Manhattan. Again, thank you so much for having us. I'm excited to, talk with each other, share the stories and, draw out some lessons together.
Awesome. Yeah, thanks for finding the time to talk to us. And finally, Amey.
Hi everybody. My name is Ameya. It's like saying a mayor, but in a New York accent, if you know what it's like. I'm sure some of y'all do, but it's the three syllables, Ameya. I am a student filmmaker. I have gotten into more organizing spaces over the last, I would say last year to 6 months to a year, a little bit since a little bit before I would say the genocide in, the began in earnest. I My campus is San Francisco State University, historically known as San Francisco State College. I'm here right now, and as you can see probably behind me, this is the this is what we have set up. There's a lot more. I can walk you through it a little bit better. I feel comfortable doing that at this point. We haven't really been facing the same kind of violence and repression, and even Zionist violence as other campuses. I primarily work in student film and independent films as a crew member and as an actor. And over the last couple of months, I've also been trying to mobilize particularly members of the South Asian community on my campus around issues such as solidarity with Palestine. And yeah, I'm just really happy to be here. Thank you so much, Green Left, for having me.
Yeah, awesome. And yeah, thanks to you all for joining us again today. I guess we'll start off. Could you tell us a bit about the background to the setting up of the Palestine Solidarity encampments at the colleges, and I guess how it kind of became such a widespread movement across so many campuses?
Cyn, do you want to take that?
Sure, I can go first. Like, so one thing to say is that none of us here in the Zoom room were really involved in the initial stages of the encampment movement. The encampments originated at Columbia, where students in the Columbia University Apartheid Divest Coalition, Kuwait Coalition, have been planning this action for months, so I hear. Some of the people that I spend the most time organizing with were at the Labor Notes Conference, which is this massive labor organizing conference that coheres the bottom-up democracy-oriented forces in the U.S. labor movement, but also, increasingly around the world. We were there when the camps first went up, and it became clear that the movement was going to explode. I remember being huddled in various conference rooms discussing the news, acknowledging to ourselves that this had the potential to be a mass movement, that it was going to take off with or without us, and that we needed to be involved. Most other camps, aside from Columbia's, have been more makeshift and impromptu. I actually don't have the best context for the first few that followed Columbia, like a day or two after. But since then, most of the camps we've seen have been incredibly makeshift, just, a couple people getting together, getting their friends together to set up tents. And I think that's really important to emphasize that, like, for a lot of these camps that came after Columbia, it is a lot of work to build an occupation, keep it going, and using it to use it as a staging ground for future escalation. It's a lot of work, but it's not hard. You don't need to be a professional revolutionary to figure out how to do this. We were talking to so many people who were excited by what they were seeing, and they were like, it was this kind of like nervous anticipation. Like, I really support this, but I don't know if I can do it on my campus. And the conversation that we had was like, the initial hurdle is like, you got to go talk to five of your friends, get some tents together, empower everyone to go talk to five more of their friends. And you can really get something started. Let's not get too precious about it. And I think one lesson that we learned very early on was the dialectic between organization and spontaneity. A lot of people were waiting for the formal institutions on their campus, to just like, get going. It was clear that wasn't going to be the case. And so, what we were like, discussing amongst ourselves is that, we should put out the call to any existing institution that wants to join, but don't count on it. A lot of the existing institutions, they're more established, they have more resources and more to lose, but, a scrappy group of, young people who are really inspired to throw themselves in the movement, they can get a couple friends together, get a couple tents together, and then we can figure out the legal support, the media, et cetera, et cetera. And so I would say for a lot of the camps that came, after the first few days, it had this very kind of makeshift impromptu character. I'll leave it there.
Awesome. Did either of you two have anything to add to that?
If I can add just a couple
things. Yeah, I can
things.
Add a little bit. Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, so someone correct me if I'm wrong, but from what I understood, that Columbia wasn't actually the very first encampment that have spawned in the country. I think we've met some people that have done either some sort of escalation work or some sort of organizing around divestment and particularly ceasefire in this specific moment. We've met some comrades at Labor Notes that have, been expelled and like gone through disciplinary action for doing that. What I think was special about Columbia is this vicious, violent reaction from the police and how visual it was for many people to see online. And I guess like witnessing this peaceful resistance and stands against genocide being crushed and, beaten and tear gassed by NYPD. And I think witnessing that kind of roared all across the country. It seemed that, a lot of people initially in New York City specifically, like the task was to like go to Colombia, right? Be outside the gates, join the protest, and that's, and in many ways, it has, I think, saved the encampment and made it go as long as it did, because the numbers were the outside. But then at some point, people realized that we got to go back to our own campuses and began setting up tents of our own. So I think, kind of in short, the brutality of it is what I think sparked this mass movement across the country. And I think initially in maybe in solidarity with what happened in Colombia, but the initial through the sort of national kind of communication and like hearing from our comrades at Colombia, the ask was clear, is that these encampments are in solidarity with Gaza, not with like Colombia specifically, even though the state repression is what I think made it ever so inflammatory.
Yeah, I can add a little bit in terms of the context for San Francisco State's encampments. I'm pretty sure we weren't really that early in terms of starting hours. I know Berkeley and a couple of other campuses had started theirs. Obviously, there's Columbia and all these other campuses that had faced widespread police violence and repression for simply protesting against genocide. I think when it comes to like my campus in particular, there's certain factors that make it a little bit more unique in terms of how we kind of organize people. For one, we are the last campus in or on American soil that still has a student organization that represents the Palestinian student body, known as the General Union of Palestine Students, or GUPS. There's GUPS chapters all over the world. The one in America, the only one in America that's left is in San Francisco State University. So there's that. The second thing about our encampments that's a little bit different is, well, our campus is primarily, commuter and working class. And also, this is ethnically one of the most diverse campuses in California, as well as the entire country. And so those are some of the things that are a little bit unique, and some of the factors on our campus that affected how we were going to organize around this. Especially after seeing the widespread, police violence that many people in many universities were facing, including Columbia, and you got, I think UCLA now is being, attacked by Zionists. But yeah, so it is a lot of work, and it did, and a lot, and that police violence and trying to sort of, not necessarily sidestep it, but being prepared for that was a large part of planning our encampment. We, our organizing kind of turned into several committees that essentially, addressed specific things that we saw that were going on in other encampments that led to either violence or just like, a narrative that the media runs that, it's about the universities or it's about the campuses. That's also another thing that we wanted to sort of center was Palestinians in Gaza instead of, us, because it's not about us. And so yeah, it was a lot of work, and it was a lot of outreach, especially reaching out to a lot of organizations like Food Not Bombs to provide food and water. We also were very, very fortunate to have had faculty support, like widespread faculty support. I can literally show you right now. Right now, there's going to be a mural celebration. This is just a couple of folks attending it. A couple of them are faculty members that, have taught classes I have attended. But basically, they're celebrating the Edward Said mural that we have on our campus, which is the only Edward Said mural on an American campus. So yeah. Like those are the types of activities we have planned. There's obviously like a lot more like teach-ins, especially directly involving members of the General Union of Palestine Students, because they're the organization that represents Palestinians on this campus. We haven't really faced a lot of violence at all, or any sort of co-opting, or any kind of nasty things that a lot of these college campuses are facing. I think we've been very, very fortunate in that regard. But I am very, very adamant in my stance that that could change any second, so we should be prepared for it, and it's something we do keep in mind, every day this encampment is ongoing, which has been, this is our third day, so yeah.
Thanks for that. I was I was going to go into, I guess, the kind of next kind of question. And I think you kind of answered some of that, but I'm also interested, obviously, hearing from the other kind of activists, which I want to hear, I guess, some of your impressions and experiences at your particular campus, specifically on how, I guess, the encampments are kind of organized, because I guess one of the incredible things about these encampments is they do actually provide, they are, in a sense, political spaces. Currently at our encampment at the University of Melbourne and University of Sydney, they're kind of like regular teach-ins being organised. There's also lots of scope for other kind of politicising sort of activities. So I'm also kind of interested in what is the kind of level of politicisation? Because, you know, you were just sort of saying before that people can, like some of these encampments have just been started by a regular 5 or 10 kind of people. Yeah, like I kind of want to hear about those kind of experiences that are happening on the encampments.
Yeah, I can get us started a little bit. So, I mean, different camps have different cultures, and I would say the culture is dependent, contingent on things like, you know, who's in the political leadership, what the organizational ecosystem of your campus looks like. Like, you know, if there's a built-out ecosystem, especially with established groups based around Palestinian identity, if that's the case, then most students and I think participants will probably look to those groups for, leadership. Whereas other campuses that, you know, had to build this, occupation from scratch, there's a lot of opportunity, I think, to set a new like political and organizational tone and you know, because there's not like an already existing context that really weighs down on people. And also the political history of the campus matters too, and I think we'll talk about this more later. You know, the UC, which has seen different iterations of student movements and different kinds of protests, the University of California has very much been a laboratory of administrative counter-organizing, I would say. You know, on the East Coast, you see a lot of repression, not so much at, you know, UC Berkeley. UC Santa Cruz just launched today. SFSU, I think, has been relatively quiet. And I think, you know, it's not like the stated, you know, strategy of the admin, but we can infer that, like, you know, they're taking this tack of like, let's not give them what they want, what the movement, you know, has needed to grow, which is like, you know, the contradictions that repression has made apparent. And so these are some factors that I think have really determined the different culture on different campuses. I'm a participant in the UC Berkeley camp. I was there last week, and also this week I've more so shifted to supporting the launch and development of occupations in California and some around the country. To speak a little bit to politicization, I would say there's a very rapid and deep politicization. You know, this movement to me feels qualitatively different from everything that I've experienced before. You know, I wasn't around for 2010's student activism, but it seems that the movement is much more mature due to the broader political context in which it exists. You know, thousands of students have been getting political experience. You know, I was politicized by Bernie. A lot of other people, you know, are Starbucks workers getting shop floor organizing experience, doing labor solidarity work these past few years, and have built relationships with faculty, campus unions, have participated in other issue-based groups and social struggles like Black Lives Matter. As compared to like Occupy, for example, this movement actually has clear communicable demands. Almost every campus, you know, has, you know, four to five BDS related demands, plus like no repression against students. You know, we are using militant direct action tactics, and there are fewer examples of ultra left acts of desperation, although I anticipate that might be more so the case if there is a lack of democracy in the movement and a chance to synthesize our tasks and develop a shared analysis. And I think there, you know, like I said before, a lot of people, you know, myself included, have had some experience with labor in one form or another. There's an instinct to forge relationships with labor and acknowledgement that students alone can't really, you know, carry this movement to its logical conclusion, that we need to catalyze action and support and build relationships with other sectors of campus and society. We're still very much at the beginning of the reformulation of the student movement, you know, given, you know, certain growing pains we've seen around various themes. I think maybe we'll get to that later in the interview, but just to name them right now, you know, around the balance to strike between democracy and security culture, national coordination, you know, sometimes cynical misuses of identity politics, and just basic questions of method. Like very few people in the student movement have experiences doing occupations, you know, running effective mass meetings. And especially I think for the socialist left, you know, the position we've taken these past few years is Or, you know, this is just a critique that I've been developing. I'm not sure if it's shared amongst the socialist left, but like, especially, you know, our organization, YDSA, or I think Daniel and I are involved in it. You know, our historically within these past few years, our tack has kind of been like, YDSA runs its own issue campaigns, like YDSA for Medicare for All or this proposition or something like that. That's one method of engaging with these movements. Another has been to be in coalition with movements, such as like, you know, two representatives of this group meets with two representatives of that group. But like, you know, there's no shared organizational life, especially for the rank and file membership of different organizations beyond that. And so I think this is a new context in which the socialist left is really throwing itself into a broader context and learning how to do mass politics. Whereas before we've kind of been a little abstentionist about things because, you know, people have critiques about the certain, you know, liberal, like kind of like, you know, NGO culture of other organizations. I think these critiques are very well taken, but the way to change this culture and improve them are not to like isolate ourselves, but to get involved and win people to our perspectives about mass action and whatnot. And so I would say, I mean, the long-term lessons and the way you know, people will be politicized, I think, you know, it's too early to determine that right now, just because of the thing that I mentioned before, that the question of democracy in those movements, how you know, if there are going to be mass meetings, if people can synthesize perspectives and formulate next steps, that is, I think, you know, it's not a really developed culture right now. And so if the movement drags on, if there are disagreements about what to do next, we can see a lot more disunity. And so, you know, in that case, people can be politicized in very different directions.
Yeah, I think, Cyn, you hit a lot of great points, a lot of, what's the expression, like, nail on the head, a lot of nails here. I think, yeah, just to maybe talk a little bit, I think I share a lot of, Cyn's analysis, specifically, like, pertaining to our organization and how we've been organizing kind of throughout my student organizing years, which I think me and Cyn have shared in many ways, kind of, but just on different coasts for the past, 3, 4, 5 years. This is something I've never personally experienced or seen in my life, or maybe even saw coming. All I, as individually, like organized socialists, was equipped with is just like my political orientation and like my political beliefs, and that is, of course, includes, believe in like liberation of Palestine and ceasefire, but also, our orientation towards like building these sorts of movement, which we've has tried to, organize and read about and like debate like internally within our group, like how do we as, organized socialists, as members of YDSA, and even like within YDSA, there are people in like organized caucuses, which like Cyn and I, we're in the same caucus together. Like, how do we develop orientation about around joining these movements? And I'm excited to talk maybe a little bit more down the line. But I want to maybe mention how the City College encampment has begun. And I think similar to UC Berkeley and like the free speech movement of the 60s, CUNY and specifically City College has a rich history of student movements and student organizing, which funny enough, the CUNY administration and the kind of CUNY system have embraced in their imagery as this, space for, like student movements and radical change. Specifically, the historical moment in CUNY is a movement for racial integration in the like the late 1960s. Something that's kind of been labeled the Five Demands, which are all surrounded, racial integration, establishment of, like African Latino studies departments, like things of that nature. And they have been done through this sort of militant direct student action. And now another sort of student direct action came onto our campuses. And instead of embracing or like listening to students' demand, CUNY have retaliated in a very violent way last night. The encampment in CUNY lasted for about a week, I think largely due to the fact that we've been on spring break and today is the first day kind of back to school. And so the night prior, the NYPD swept the camp in its entirety in a very violent, very oppressive manner. It's tough to even imagine like the views that have simultaneously have happened at Columbia last night, where the SWAT teams and like armed police guards broke into the building filled with peaceful protesting students, and kind of trying to seeing that in the in real time on my phone, and then looking up from the phone and see a, you know, a group of police officers storming towards me because I'm standing outside of City College is has felt very surreal. And I think this shared experience would be extremely shaping for many participants. But yeah, I guess like to the question of like how these encampments came to be in specific campuses at City College, it again came to be as a collection of like Palestinian organizing groups, maybe some of the political organizing groups, or even individuals. Because CUNY is a system of campuses, it drew like faculty and student leadership from different kind of parts of the city. And so it wasn't just like this one campus, student body of this campus. It was a collection of people, collection of different, you know, backgrounds and organizing experiences, levels of political development, I don't know, age. And I guess like maybe we'll talk a little bit about it later, but you know, initial stages were sort of very kind of closed off. Like the leadership was sort of unknown to people that were like, this is happening. Like people were vetted on like this will happen, like join this group chat where you know you're not able to send messages but get notifications. Was you know like that's how you would get involved basically and just kind of wait for leaders to jump the gun and tell you what to do. And again, it's like it's the debate and critique around like again, like Sinip said, issues of security versus democratization. And then once it happens, once you know the kind of domino falls, like what's then? How do we maintain this sort of culture? Like how do we democratize this movement? And maybe that's more on the role of like socialists in these social movements that we should also discuss.
I think for historical context, also as a state has somewhat of a history of somewhat of significant history of student organizing, and it's also one that they like to kind of fall back on as like, oh, SF State is like this real like this campus that's like really famous for the longest and largest student strike in U.S. history, which it was in 1968, and that was for the Civil Rights Movement. I feel like all the students here feel a sort of disconnect with the administration and their position on Palestinian liberation. When it comes to the connection of the left to this particular encampment, one of our organizers literally got the not necessarily the idea, but the sort of resolve to organize folks around building tents for in solidarity for at labor notes, which I think somebody mentioned, because at labor notes there was a lot of people they had said who had come to labor notes and were talking about how they had faced repression for speaking up about Palestine, and these included students from universities like Vanderbilt University, and I think also probably Columbia, but not can't, it can't be particularly sure, but I do remember Vanderbilt. And a lot of Palestinian students as well at that labor notes conference who were basically just asking one of our organizers like, okay, so like this is happening all over the country. Where are you? Like, what? Why haven't you done anything yet? Like, where's your tents? That was a factor, but it wasn't the entire reason why, or and it was definitely not the entire motivation behind starting it. It was mainly just, but yeah, I do want to touch on something important, and that is every campus it has very specific demands, and those demands could be different from campus to campus. So I'm gonna show you what SF State is demanding right now, which I don't know if, is this flipped for y'all? I don't know how to flip this
Well, we
back.
can see it.
Is
We
this
can read
flipped?
it.
Huh? Oh, okay, cool. So, yeah. So we want our specific university to disclose how much or what companies it spends our tuition dollars on that are complicit in the genocide as this. We want the California State University system as a whole, which our campus is a part of, to divest from the companies that we know that they invest in that are complicit in the genocide in Gaza. We want the administration of this campus to defend its Palestinian student body and to, you know, reject and oppose bills, Senate bills specific to the state Senate in California, such as Senate Bill 1287, which curbs students' right to protest around Palestine, and to declare this what's happening as a genocide and an ethnic cleansing. So that's our demands. That doesn't necessarily mean every campus's demands will be the same. Every campus looks different. Every campus's relationship to the military and to the weapons manufacturing companies that are complicit in the genocide in Gaza are different. So, you know, that's just us. But one thing I want to also touch on is, like, I don't think any of this would have been possible without without a primarily leftist and a socialist perspective on community organizing. We have folks from organizations such as Party for Socialism and Liberation, as well as well, Palestinian orgs such as Palestinian Youth Movement that are helping us make this a reality. So, yeah, and a lot of folks, a striking amount of folks that are involved with the organizing of all this are members of YDSA here in San Francisco State University, the chapter that exists here, as well as some of which, myself included, are members of DSA National, which is Democratic Socialists of America, but, like, you know, it's the national member, the national umbrella sort of org, of which YDSA, I guess, are a part of. So, yeah, I think, you know, working with each other and learning from each other was a very key factor in doing all this. I want to touch on, like, some of the tactics that we're using in terms of like bringing a sense of togetherness for our campus and just like the people that are camping here. We have like committees, so we have like a media committee, a security committee, a resources committee, and a medical committee. A medics committee and an activities committee. Activities consist of teach-ins and you know, mural celebrations like the one for Edward Said right now, and those are primarily to include and to learn from members of the Palestinian student body so that they could educate others about Palestine. That's activities. Medic community medic committees for, you know, if anyone gets hurt, anybody needs medicine. If everybody's got allergies, you know, they need antihistamine or something like that. Here's a little look at the tent right now. This is what we got. I mean, we have a lot more, but, like, you know, this is, you know, a general sense of what it looks like. And, you know, that's what that's for, the medic committee. Media is for folks, designated folks, so that they can talk to press or take pictures or, you know, work on the social media posts that we're trying to get people to see so that they can see what's happening and they can join in, and to encourage people to join in by, you know, telling them how much of their tuition money goes to the genocide, you know, telling them how much money, for example, does CSU spend on these high risk securities, which are basically just stocks and bonds that invest in majority, like, you know, lots of different companies, but a lot of that money is, you know, for Boeing and Lockheed Martin, which is complicit in the genocide, for example, right? So that's what media is for. I think security is for legal stuff and cops, obviously, and, like, you know, and also just, like, you know, unfriendly people or people that are causing problems that aren't necessarily related to Zionism. You know, just, like, you know, keeping an eye out for, you know, each other, keeping each other safe. That's what security is for. As well as, like, a strong legal backing. Like, we contacted the National Lawyers Guild here in California so that, you know, if anything happens, they kind of have our back. We have a jail support plan, for example, as well, if we face that kind of thing, like arrests or police violence. We have legal observers who will essentially, you know, record what the cops do if they do anything. And then the last committee I think I was going to touch on was, let's see, media, security, medic, Oh, resources. Yeah, resources is basically food, water, outreach for all that kind of stuff. You know, outreach to several organizations. Faculty members sometimes provide stuff too, or just like community members, students, alumni. You know, but like, yeah, taking inventory of that. You know, making sure we're not missing anything, and if we are missing anything, sending folks on runs to go get it, or you know, contacting other orgs to you know, help source those things. And I also want to make it very clear that like what SF State is doing in terms of, you know, the leadership for our tents or I guess our encampment is more so like democratic in a way. Like we had a vote today, for example, to literally just like democratically elect leaders for to decide with the community, of course, what this movement will look like going forward. You know, potentially even after the genocide ends, which I hope it ends soon, but you know, you never know. Sorry. Yeah. So, and also I want to add that those leaders will lead alongside members of the Palestinian student body, primarily members of, you know, GUPS. Like, you know, it's like they're on the same level.
It's
not,
good. We can read it.
One's not, one doesn't have precedence over the other or anything like that. Well, I guess Palestinian students do, but like, anyway, but like, because we do want to center them as much as we can, but also we don't want to give them the brunt of the work or put the, make them take like the fall or anything. Because we do want to protect them as much as we can, because they are the most vulnerable folks on this campus. If, you know, if the cops come or you know, the administration comes down hard on us. But yeah, that's some of the things that SF State is doing a little, maybe a little differently. We're not really sure, because you know every year their campus has its own way of doing this and organizing folks. But yeah, this is how SF State's doing it right now.
Yeah, oh, thank you for that. First of all, it's nice to meet you all. We've all been really inspired by the student mobilizations happening across the US, and it's really sparked things off here in Australia. So you've touched on a little bit about this, but the encampments and the other disruptive protests have been met with severe repression from the establishment. And we've seen the kind of state violence against young people standing up for the rights of Palestinian people, and also how you've been portrayed in the media. So together with that intense repression by police through raids and things, would you be able to tell us about that dynamic?
Sure. Yeah, I wanted to speak a little bit on like the events that maybe occurred last night, where a large kind of NYPD presence stormed two campuses. Yeah, so something I maybe forgot to mention in the around previous question, but the CUNY and City College specifically are two things. One, it's a public university. It's a, you know, state-sponsored, state-run college. City College specifically is a kind of publicly accessible campus. So we've camped in a very publicly accessible lawn, which is like a campus quad, which brought, I guess, two things. One, we were able to create a space of community where it's not just limited to members of, you know, CUNY students and CUNY faculty and staff, but to members of the local Harlem community. You know, we had parents, we had camps and children, in the camp, a lot of programming, kind of daily included activities for children. Like we had a lot of chalks, we had a lot of art build, we had toys, we had like playing balls for kids to come in and enjoy kind of this communal space for Palestine. And like, they were running around with like Palestinian flags and like free Gaza stickers or something like that. So that's one aspect of it. The other aspect is a lot of dangers that could potentially arise with the publicly accessible space for encampments, such as, of course, like threat of, you know, Zionists violently like storming in and, you know, like maybe, you know, causing havoc. At war, at best, it would have been just like maybe a vocal confrontation, which have happened, and like security team managed to, you know, escort them out kind of peacefully. And at worst, like there's, you know, maybe always kind of high risk of like someone armed coming into this camp, which, glad, like, thank God didn't happen. So that's two things that I think I wanted to kind of set up for what I'm about to say is that happened yesterday. So far I've spent nearly every day in that camp and spent several nights in that camp as well. And yesterday was like very, very intense. There was a march of like Palestinian students, Palestinian protesters that have marched from Columbia, which is like, probably the most famous encampment, up just around like 30 blocks here in Manhattan, to our city college, to our encampment. And I guess I want to say this with like clear intention and clear weight. Before like police make like mass arrests and before police like handcuffs or like zip ties students and protesters, they always like they have to make a call for people to disperse. And organizers always keep that in mind so that people who cannot get arrested for like legal status or some sort of personal risk assessment, they have a moment to disperse and, not get arrested. When the march came in, police just isolated the whole campus. Like they locked people inside in what essentially have happened, and again, I want to kind of put a lot of weight on this, an open air prison. And I think similarities here are very clear. And I think this is where, if not before, like a week prior, this is where it really became apparent that, the boot of every NYPD officer is laced by an IOF soldier. And again, like there were children and parents in the camp when the camp got locked out by the barricades and like cop cars and buses. People were not kind of allowed to leave. Many people managed to sneak out when like a little bit of commotion came in, with a lot of people managed to get out safely. It was all followed with tear gas, sorry, not tear gas, but like pepper sprays and batons, clear altercations while people were trying to find their way out. And that's when the moment, like the realization came in that they are coming in for a sweep, which was expected actually the morning after. So the Wednesday morning, there was an expectation that the sweep would come in. It happened way earlier. And I was out of the camp. I was expecting a sweep. So myself, I said that, I need to return. I need to help protect it. And like I left the camp for the evening. And as soon as I saw what happened, I was like, we need to turn around. We need to go back. We need to like help. We need to be there. And as soon as I came in, it was just like army of police and army of very visual image of how it occurred. It was police was clearly disorganized and undisciplined because they were kind of running amok in some ways, running into the crowd, dispersing, and that triggered a lot of violence again against people that were didn't like escalate on their own accord, or in many cases got like victims of just kind of being the bystander or being in a person who got stuck at the wrong place at the wrong time, seemingly on a, like a public sidewalk, because people that managed to escape the camp got locked out on the opposite side of the campus, so just like on a public street. And that would happen at City College, and it's been like we saw like tasers, we saw batons, like people just thrown to the ground. And in the moment it felt kind of mild compared to what we saw occurring in Colombia and like what we were listening in at their like radio station. It was just like the there's like an imagery of like draw gun by an officer that was storming the building that students have occupied. The like the military vehicles were there, this like sort of storming auto ladder, whatever mechanism that was. It was absolutely insane to see videos of like students getting thrown down the stairs and not being able to get medical help. I mean, this was all just like so revealing. And immediately I think what the way people made connection was, this is happening in quote unquote, like American, like blue city, right? Like the Democratic mayor, the Democratic governor, currently the Democratic president. And I think like maybe we can talk a little bit more about it, but the context of like American like presidential elections right now, I think is extremely, extremely important. And what have happened over like past few days, I think has been like decisive to many people in the youth and like process of like politicization against the Democratic Party, I think has been a very, very, very swift one, something that they probably didn't expect themselves, but something that like Biden and the Democrats have certainly brought onto themselves by escalating in such violent manner by denouncing the student, the peaceful, again, peaceful student protesters. And so how it's now playing out, it seems, I'll admit, I have not been following a lot of like, again, like mainstream, like social media, but it seems that naturally these instances of like violent escalation by police got like caught in like eye of like New York Times, BBC, and I guess just like the sheer like mass scale of it had maybe draw some sympathies of people in the newsroom where like maybe the instance was like focusing on this police escalation, but again, there's no like centering Gaza and is now often like clear articulation of what the demands are, like what's the analysis of this, so like why is this happening? So maybe like I can't really say much about like how what's the analysis of the mainstream media, but it's been caught on. People are talking about it and people are witnessing the violence. I think the visual of it is the most powerful thing about what's being reported, and people actively saying that this is horror and this is scary. And a lot of, I think, political gears are turning in people's heads with or without their, I guess, like realization. And I think it will have very serious political consequences, first of all, today, and then later, of course, in November.
Yeah, I can jump in on this too. I mean, just before I say what the repression signifies, I just want to say how crazy it is. The repression is immensely intense, disproportionate, heinous, and just impossible to construe as anything other than warfare. You know, it sounds like a hyperbole, but consider this. You know, hundreds and hundreds of police descended on Columbia and City College last night, tear gassing students, throwing them downstairs, nonchalantly texting each other, "Oh, I thought we shot a student." You know, it's insane. You know, the gates at Columbia are locked. No one can get in or out. I heard reports of like water and Wi-Fi being shut off. At UCLA, a Zionist mob attacked the UCLA camp for hours, macing peaceful protesters, setting fireworks off into their camps, throwing down their barricades. On Twitter, I saw a report that people injected something into mice and threw them into the camp. You know, so it's just unlike anything I've seen before. Just one other thing I want to mention that was just so harrowing this week. You know, students at Emerson faced a sweep earlier, and there was so much bloodshed that, like, the day after, they had to call in workers to hose the blood off the walls and the floor. So it just the amount of violence is just disproportionate, and there's no precedent. And you know, one just really remarkable thing is that students have been unwavering in the face of it. It's just like so heartbreaking and inspiring at the same time. I just don't have words. And as for what the repression reveals, you know, it's revealing what we knew all along. You know, the institutions in our society are not accountable to us, not accountable to our professors, to, you know, our TAs, you know, other campus workers, the general public, voters. No, they're accountable to the Board of Trustees, which is accountable to the rest of the ruling class. You know, you look up who sits on these boards of trustees, you will find a rogues gallery of supervillains with investments in apartheid regimes, arms manufacturers, companies that are just at the very bottom of the totem pole of what deserves our investment and social support. And this moment's also revealing that, you know, the ruling class is the per you know the they're the perpetrators of violence. You know, the methods and tactics of protesters have been overwhelmingly peaceful. In some cases, there hasn't been any escalation besides just like pitching tents and having a couple signs on campus. When there is provocation, our side has been extremely disciplined about sticking to nonviolent tactics and drawing out the hypocrisy of the ruling class and the Zionist lobby. You know, you can go online and see countless videos of protesters at UCLA holding the line while Zionists spit on them, yell racist slurs, trying to, you know, manhandle them. You know, the last night the cops were called in and just watched this for hours, letting the Zionist mob, you know, do its damage before stepping in, you know, the middle of the night. And one other thing I'll say is that I was exchanging like articles or an email with a comrade earlier today, and they pointed out that these crimes are, you know, being done under the auspices of a more diverse ruling elite. The mayor of Boston is Asian. The mayor of Atlanta is Black. The president of Colombia is Arab. The ruling elite might have a new face, but the violence is all the same. And this speaks to the absolute bankruptcy of neoliberal identity politics, which props people like, you know, Barack Obama up as solutions for a crisis. No, this is a fundamental crisis of capitalism, of imperialism, and students have been unmistakably clear about that.
I would also like to add that, you know, identity politics to the level to the neoliberal level that is plaguing a lot of these institutions. I think SF State is also you know, at least when it comes to the administration of this college, SF State has also faced some of that as well. Just a lot of just like, oh, look at how diverse our campus administration is, but like the kinds of things they do, or like, you know, the CSU president, who is a person of color, but, you know, is very, very anti Palestine protests and, you know, has been raising tuition for everybody. I mean, there's a laundry list of issues, I guess, but I want to make it very clear that though we at SF State have not faced nearly, and I mean nearly, the kind of repression and violence that is happening in other universities, that we are seeing the violence happen every day. We are, that is informing how we do our security. That is informing how we, you know, how we converse with our, with each other, with our comrades about things. You know, we are open. We are an open encampment, and we are on public property, but, you know, these are things that, you know, it's very, very concerning seeing the level of violence that has taken place in all these universities, and the tactics that these cops are using against the students, which is absolutely despicable and is very reminiscent of the kind of tactics that the IOF has been using against Palestinians for years and years and years. And yeah, I there's some really, really scary parallels there. And we're seeing this, and we do not, we wish it would not happen, obviously, but obviously, like, you know, we have to be prepared for the scenario in which something like that comes our way, and so that is informing us one, and we are trying to, well, this is a very new thing, this is literally as of last night, but we want to build inroads with encampments across the country that are facing the kind of repression that they are, to stand in support of them as well. Obviously, I think solidarity with Gaza takes place first. But I think that's something that is kind of a de facto thing, and it's something that is like, it goes without saying, I guess, for a lot of these encampments around the country. Like, we already kind of know, whether it's SF State or Columbia or Vanderbilt or, you know, Hunter College or any of these other colleges, that we're not really here for the vibes or the food or the water, or, you know, for us or whatever like that. We are really here for the people of Gaza. But if standing up against the genocide means facing the scale of the kind of violence we're seeing in college campuses across the country right now, then obviously we have to kind of do our part, and we are indebted to kind of do our part to stand against that kind of violence, and you know, to stand in support of other college campuses. I would like to add also that we are using primarily nonviolent tactics. I think this is something that most encampments have been doing anyways. It kind of goes without saying as well. But we have been very, very peaceful. I think so far the administration has been kind of ambivalent or has found us peaceful. I know there has been some members of administration that have been like, oh, you guys are, it's whatever, it's fine. Which obviously you can't really trust that. But like, you know, I think that down the line, you know, it could get worse. And we're prepared for that possibility from every front we can prepare from. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
Oh, thanks for that. I think this is all being very fascinating, but also quite horrifying in a lot of ways. And in fact, looking at some of the footage in New York, it's actually to be honest, it almost feels like I'm looking at a war zone, essentially, on a lot of ways. And this is supposed to be in one of the most advanced liberal democracies in the world. That's not like those terrible countries in the Middle East where, you know, they're supposed to be in state of permanent war. We're supposed to, the United States is supposed to be this beacon of sort of enlightenment. And I think those sort of images really kind of breaks apart that narrative in a lot of ways. I think some of the comments here kind of lead quite well into this next question, which is, we're sort of interested in, given all these sort of different conditions of the encampments, because I noticed that, you know, there was a comment implying that there's obviously political debates happening about how to kind of take this in this movement kind of forward, and I guess I want to kind of hear. What are some of those kind of political debates? And of course, how does it link up with the kind of political lessons that people are kind of drawing from these kind of experiences? And of course, we also talked a bit, you've already talked a bit about the role that the organized left is kind of playing in obviously building these encampments. But I also, guys, we're also wanting to hear about, I guess, what is the kind of positions that the organized left is putting forward in terms of these debates?
Wow, that's a lot of questions. I have a lot of thoughts. You might have to prompt us again about that, but I can say a little bit about just like some basic political lessons that we've taken away and then just run very quickly through some themes or criticisms or just observations that we've had. But just, I'll get to those in a second. So I, like I said before, I would say the long-term lessons of this movement have yet to be seen because the movement is just so decentralized, you know, individuals of local camps, you know, have been in contact with each other as individuals, but there's no like formal coordination. Who's to say like, you know, what the, you know, perspectives of the movement are. As for basic political lessons, I mean, you know, one thing that this is teaching people is that the supposedly liberal and democratic institutions in our society, like you said, are in fact class institutions. You know, our endowments, which fund our research and initiatives, are bound up in the most brutal repressive systems in society, and our BDS related demands, I think, you know, really reflect that awareness. There's also the, you know, the recognition of the abject failure of the mainstream political leadership offered by, you know, the Republican and Democratic parties. At the SFSU rally yesterday, there was a speaker who posed our 2024 election choices as a choice between a fascist and a genocidal pro-war incumbent. And, you know, people in this movement know that the Democratic Party cannot be a vehicle for social change to win a ceasefire, for example. And the question of a working class political party is particularly vexed in the American, you know, context where we have an extremely punishing two-party system and, you know, various other factors in place to guarantee that any third, you know, party challengers are going to be punished. People in this movement, you know, I think this generation is going to make possible new political horizons. You know, imagine if all these people in this movement were won over to the need to long-term organization. The political shifts that would affect in existing institutions, I think, would be just unquantifiable. The other day, I was just like entertaining this thought experiment is like, you know, imagine like half this movement would join DSA. Like right now, DSA is very much, you know, a lot of people from the outside think it's like another arm of the Democratic Party. And maybe there's some nuances to dispute there, but like, you know, most people's political experiences in this organization are predominantly electoral and through like, you know, more passive political processes of radicalization, just like voting for Bernie Sanders. This generation, on the other hand, they're forging the fire of the student movement. They already have an instinctual distrust of the Democratic and Republican parties. Imagine if they join like socialist political organizations, what kind of new perspectives and, you know, movement building that would make possible. I think this moment has also compelled people to look more deeply into, you know, U.S. history of intervention and imperialism and, you know, equally emancipatory movements built against those things. You know, I've seen a few articles, both from the organized left as well as more recently radicalized people and onlookers who have, you know, pointed out analogies with the anti-war movement, the free speech movement at Berkeley's campus, the anti-apartheid divestment movement in the 80s. And so people are looking to the past and to, you know, for answers or clues about how to build this movement right now, which is really promising. Although, you know, like I mentioned before, I think the organized left has not established enough these movements to really popularize our views about what lessons should be taken from this moment. And from another angle, there's like very little leadership that we can provide in the sense that, you know, we can have all these ideas about how to build a mass movement, you know, what our theory of change should be. But the fact is that, you know, in this newly revitalized socialist left, Our generation has very little experience building mass movements, and partially that's like an outcome of like the kind of orientation I mentioned earlier about like YDSA and other socialist groups kind of having an abstentionist position towards these movements, where they say other groups are too liberal, or it's like too hard to work with people I disagree with, and they're not won over to a maximal program. And so we've not been in like a room together with participants of these movements before, arguing over what the best strategy for the movement is, and that's actually really biting us in the ass, because like a lot of us now, it's been great that YDSA has been so flexible, recognize the opportunity and excitement and of this moment to get involved, and that's just been really incredible. But our ability to really help develop the leadership or set political lines is really compromised, given the fact that we're just throwing ourselves in, whereas like other groups like SJP, JVP, PYM have been laying the groundwork for months and years and are able to really shape the debate on our campuses right now. As for the debates you were asking about, forgive me if I'm a little rambly, I'm going to try to rattle them off. So there are a bunch of questions that have come up, and not really in like formal spaces, and one of the main reasons why, and one debate I think the left should increasingly raise, not necessarily as a left to make these lines factionalized, but as individual participants of the movement. One important theme is the relationship between democracy and security culture. In a lot of these camps, you will not see open meetings necessarily, where people can discuss like how the movement is doing, what we should do next, and mostly this is not motivated by people who are just cynical and trying to like control the camp or anything. It's more so motivated by security culture. People don't want to reveal our plans. This is why you see practices like everyone can only text each other through Signal. We can't have open meetings and stuff like that. And it's, I understand the concerns. There are real consequences to building this movement. Look at all the repression that's happening, but like there needs to be a balance, because there's no way we can win without democracy, without bringing in more people, without developing the leadership of the ranks. If you don't have a sense of how your camp is doing, how can you feel confident about what the future is going to look like? And of course, the democracy is not just an abstract ideal. It's about power. It's, how can we form a good strategy, develop creative tactics without bringing people together? That's not to say that everything needs to be a big open mass meeting. There are different concentric circles is how, we're starting to discuss this, and different layers of coordination and discussion. And so I think the left, has to be, one, we have to organize ourselves to like recognize this critique and what it means for how we orient to the movement, and then we should socialize this analysis within the movement. Maybe I heard, a comrade who had some experience actually in the 2010 student movement at UC Santa Cruz say this, like mass meetings, oftentimes are really ineffective because sometimes there's just like 10 hours of people vibe checking in or venting. There's a time and a place for that. That's not a mass meeting where your goal is to get everyone on the same page. And like, for him, they were most effective when you oriented everyone in that room around a question, like, should we escalate or not? Usually a yes or no question like that, you would have people debating for and against. And at the end, you would empower different like task forces to like, figure out if you could escalate in that way, or, empower a smaller group of leadership to figure out the plans. This is all to say that there are different levels of democracy and coordination, and most of the camps right now do not have something like that. So anyways, the reason I brought up this first is because without democracy, we can't even get all the other issues and strategic questions on the table. So there's, the question of like messaging, the role of repression. I've seen some camps say like, we shouldn't talk about this at all because somehow it's like decentering us and decentering Palestine and centering us. So other people might have the contention that actually these two things are the same, two sides of the same coin. We need free speech in order to fight for Palestine, and we have to build a dynamic, sophisticated mass movement that can weather ups and downs and keep people in for the long haul. And so whether we talk about repression and use creative tactics centered around community building, that is something that we have to debate and decide for ourselves. There's the question of, sorry, I'm going on for a long time. Maybe I'll let these other comrades go first, but I just have a lot of thoughts doing. There's a question of coordination. You brought up the question of like, how can the socialist stuff intervene? There's not really discussion around this right now. The three of us in this room were either members of YDSA or other socialist groups, but we're more so just like so consumed with building our local occupations that it's been hard to like figure out how we can cohere ourselves as a group, develop a shared analysis and a shared strategy for the movement, and whether that strategy or intervention should be expressed as like the intervention of socialists, which I'm personally not for at this moment. I think we should primarily be like sincere builders of the mass movement and try to socialize our perspective in the movement, as opposed to factionalize things as like democracy is the only the prerogative of the socialists. I don't think that that's the case. You know, other people share those views, and like we should be careful not to say like, you know, democracy is the special position that YDSA is staking out here. So that's where I'm coming from. There's a question of escalation. So a lot of camps right now, in my understanding, are very concerned with reproducing themselves on a day-to-day basis. Do I have enough food? Is someone going to do the training tomorrow? I think not too many right now are looking, are discussing like external outreach and how to build up their forces to force some, you know, bigger confrontations in the future. And that's really important because we shouldn't assume that the camps are going to grow on their own. It's a very visible tactic, but some people don't see themselves as activists. Some people don't understand why they themselves need to be involved. And so we need to go out and reach them. And it's not the case that right now that any campus is like fully saturated. Maybe Columbia is almost there, but I guarantee you there are a million other tactics we have to try to win more of the campus over, to establish relationships with other people on campus. And sorry, another, you guys should stop me whenever you feel like, because I'm just going to keep talking. Another thing I've been thinking about is like, you know, I'm at Berkeley. A lot of the schools here have not seen intense repression. And so this has actually like caused a lot of concern, or like, you know, hesitancy for about the prospects of our movement, because a lot of people are like, oh, those other camps have grown a lot, or like have been able to get in the media because of the repression. Well, you know, the administration's not giving us that. So what does that mean about our strategy? Like I said before, like the UCs have seen a lot of this, and so are like a terrain or a testing ground for like administrative counter-organizing, but I don't think this fundamentally changes our strategy. We should build up our forces and then figure out how to up the ante through escalations, whether that means changing from soft pickets to hard pickets, or doing civil disobedience, or like going after, you know, administrators, protesting outside their houses and stuff like that. I don't think it fundamentally changes the strategy, but like, you know, we have to get sophisticated about how we grow our movement in order to escalate. There are a bunch of other things I'll just put on the table right now, what to do about the end of the semester. You know, the camp is not an end in itself. How can it be a staging area for like other kinds of things? And the fact that students, you know, like I said before, can't carry this to this logical conclusion by themselves. So how do we get other forces involved and develop like a shared strategy with them? So those are just some things. Yeah.
I actually want to add to that, because you touched on something very interesting, which is that, you know, god-awful binary of a political system that we have in America, the two-party system, that gives us the Democrats on one side and the Republicans on the other. For context, I'm the media liaison here at the SF State Camp. And so I talk to, you know, the press a lot, or not like a lot, you know, like whenever, like, you know, media liaisons, I guess, are the people that we direct the press people to. So one of the press members I remember talking to, at first their questions were like not super hostile or anything. Their talking points were very, or like their line of questioning was very, very much like the usual, like, why are you out here? And like, how long will you be out here? How do you think the student body has reacted to the genocide? Although they didn't really call it genocide, but yeah. One of the questions that they asked me, which took me by surprise, was what's next for the Democratic Party? And that really, it caught me so by surprise. I was like, what? Like, you're asking me? I wouldn't say that, obviously, but like, you know, I really don't think many people here, like, care too much about the two-party system, especially when it's a Democratic, like, this is happening under a Democratic president and under a Democratic Senate in our country. You know, this aiding and abetting of the Israeli genocide of Palestinians in Gaza. So, I mean, like, it's completely tone deaf and this is something that mainstream news does so often here in the U.S., where they will make it about the Democratic Party and the Republican Party and the two-party system, and like, you know, like, oh, and it was a little easier to do under when the United States was under the presidency of the now former President Donald Trump, because, you know, I think it's like an easy target, right? Like, you have somebody who's like openly a fascist, not even a good one at that, The mainstream media would just like run with all these stories like, oh, Trump's doing this, Trump's doing that, you know, this is bad for foreign policy, this and that. And now we have a Democratic president, Joe Biden, who is doing admittedly really, really, really bad things in terms of, you know, his aiding and abetting, his aid and abetment of the Israeli genocide of the Palestinians. Yeah, I just think it's very telling that mainstream media here likes to run with that a lot, and that the and that there's a disconnect between that side of, you know, society, which I think, you know, I feel like the media, especially some of the more well-known outlets here, are ultimately, you know, they're outlets for the ruling class, by the ruling class, and of the ruling class, and there is definitely a disconnect between what they think of what folks think about, you know, the genocide and the relationship of the Democratic Party to it compared to the actual people on the ground who are like, yeah, like, fuck the Democrats for this. Like, because, like, you know, they are complicit. A lot of the Democrats in the Senate, you know, voted to, you know, we voted for aid to Israel and military aid at that. So, yeah, I just think it's very telling. And I'm glad that like most people here are critical of this administration. Like, yeah, I think given the choice between the Democrats and the Republicans, objectively the less worse choice is the Democrats, just because the Republicans are extremely right wing. But like at the same time, like, you know, the being critical of the administration that we have right now, especially in the moment that we live in right now, which is 200 days past since the genocide in Gaza started in earnest, I think it's very important to criticize and be critical of the institutions that have, you know, aided and abetted this genocide, and the institutions that, you know, continue to do so, whether it's through our tuition dollars or through our tax money. And so, yeah, that's all I wanted to add.
Thanks very much. Comprehensive overview of the kind of political debate and the role of the organized left is playing. I guess we're down to our last kind of few questions now, but I just was going to ask about the role of the organized working class. So you mentioned how, you know, a lot of the encampments are just trying to kind of maintain themselves, and, you know, that's a challenge in and of itself. And then it's also to look to possibilities of expanding. So I just wanted to ask how the kind of working class, you know, the organizations, the unions have they played any role in the encampments, and is there kind of any worker union solidarity being built among them?
Yeah, I guess I can start us off about like the encampment worker union solidarity, which I think has been critical for this moment. I think maybe I'll start with something else. At the camp, I had probably like one of the biggest honors ever of, you know, beyond just being a participant in this like historical student movement. I had a chance to give a teach-in where we read Peter Kameo's very, I guess, like famous immortal speech on liberalism, ultra-leftism, mass action, which I guess like speaks on like how do we inject our politics organically into this space? How do we orient ourselves and the part of that's awesome. Yeah, no, that's sick. Great. Sorry to like go into the chat. I'll probably close it just to not get distracted. But yeah, I had a chance to give this teaching, and where we read like little excerpts of the speech and maybe like brought in some analysis of what's happening today, and, you know, trying to, I guess, like envision the idea of like building mass movement to win the demand. And one of the specific quotes that, you know, stood out, because this is, I think, undoubtedly a student movement, but it has a great potential to become a greater mass movement for, you know, free Gaza, for free speech, you know, against repression. And Peter Kameo said that the number one point which the ruling class understood perfectly was that decisive power does not lie within the student movement, but that the student movement is a direct danger because it can act as a catalyst, spreading ideas and setting other forces into motion. And I think this is exactly spot on. I want to highlight one specific moment from the CUNY Gaza Solidarity Encampment on 2 days ago. That was, I guess, today's Wednesday. So it seems like a Sunday night, I think, or Monday night. Over 100 members of our faculty and staff union at CUNY, like all campuses, like full-time professors, adjuncts, staff members are represented by the same union all across the city, which is like over a 40,000 member, I believe, union. A lot of, members have participated and helped build the encampment both at the core and as the rank and file members. And they held their own little, I guess, like, well, I wouldn't call it little, like over 100 members showed up, their assembly of, these activists in the union that came to the encampment, that care about this movement, that care about ending the genocide. And they've voted officially to endorse the demands that the CUNY Gaza Solidarity Encampment had put out, which I've mentioned this briefly earlier, but they drew on this historical five demands movement. And we call it similarly, we hold it for five demands for, boycott, divestment, for solidarity, for demilitarization, and of course for free CUNY, like fighting austerity, connecting issues of class and Gaza and Palestine. And many people became referring as Palestine is like our vanguard, is like the liberation litmus test. And the assembly of CUNY like professors and staff, union members, was to relay and begin like organizing people in their union, begin organizing union leadership, which from the get-go kind of began was very conservative around like how do they relate to this movement. And the potential of that was immense. I think following after, many professors began organizing a sick out. They began organizing it very publicly, right? In defiance of something that is in New York State is referred to as Taylor Law, which prohibits public employees of like public institutions to go on strike. Which again, like CUNY is a public institution. So if you're a professor at CUNY, you are a public employee. And it was a very powerful moment, both for like members of the union, those like hundreds of activists, and the participants in the Gaza encampment. It is probably one of the most like well, the most memorable one, the most brightest moments. It felt like we're converging such an immense amount of forces together, and such, and like we're gonna like pull the levers of power here. And that's just what happened at CUNY, right? Because I think worth mentioning also what happened in New York City is the violence swept of the NYU encampment, their first one, and how much the UW, the United Auto Workers Union, the Region 9A, which is the sort of New York kind of state and surrounding region, have reacted saying that, you have been like harassing and arresting our members, like a lot of NYU student workers, like graduate students, and just like campus workers are members of the UAW, both at NYU and Columbia, actually. And Union made a very kind of open stance that, like, you're arresting and you're harassing our members, there are going to be repercussions. And now there seems to be some sort of something is bubbling, I would say, in the labor movement around Palestine and around this movement to which the students became a serious catalyst that I think will have power to wield serious change. Sean Fain, the president of UW, the newly elected leader out of this like democratic reform movement, like the bottom up rank and file troublemaking wing of the labor movement, he made a statement in support of like arrested students, calling for ceasefire, calling to the end of the genocide, and saying that the unions should protect their members, should student unions should protect their rank and file from this repression, and we should end the war. And I think this is a big shift in rhetoric and big shift in attitude that I think will inspire many more, and I think will then inspire people to join these unions. And I think our task is, socialists is like, how do we capture that student movement energy and then maybe direct them into the labor movement? How do we maybe prevent like the NGOization of this like activism culture? How do we prevent, these radicals that have forced their consciousness in the struggle from, like all going to like grad school and then writing about these events years later as maybe another wave of repression is coming in? or like how do we all like prevent American from like into going to law schools, but how do we direct them into the labor movement, like embedding them with the working class, which is, you know, where the masses are. And if we really believe that workers themselves are agents of change, and if students can be catalysts of that change, then that's where we should be. But yeah, I'm it's, you know, I guess like maybe exciting is not the right word, but I must say that something is really bubbling in the labor movement and is going to be extraordinary to see what will happen. I apologize if I went a little bit long.
Thanks, Daniil. Yeah, I agree. There's been like an immense outpouring of solidarity from labor already, you know, countless videos online of faculty linking arms, saying to get through our students, you have to get through us. Today, teaching assistants at UC Santa Cruz just did a massive walkout. My union, UAW Local 4811, is calling a strike vote for next week. You know, we had a lot of individuals too in our union participating in the camps. And like Daniil said, we should be clear that this is not coming out of nowhere. You know, the left and labor have been revitalized within the last decade. Even though the left is not really part and parcel of the most, you know, strategic sectors of the labor movement yet. I mean, we do have representation there, but we're not necessarily like the leadership of the UAW or the International Brotherhood of Teamsters, not, you know, really leaders of the class yet. Even if that's not the case, we are much more involved in labor than we were a decade ago, you know, and this is the result of processes like Trump's election, ushering people into DSA, Bernie's presidential campaign, social movement struggles, mass strikes by educators and healthcare workers, radicalizing a whole new generation and encouraging them to not only turn their eyes to the labor movement, but turn their commitments to the labor movement as well. Like Daniil said, often encouraging young people like us to think about how we can make you know, the rest of our lives about winning social justice. You know, some people think the best way to do that is to join an NGO. No, you know, YDSA is saying, you know, make your join the right labor movement as a rank and file, build democratic, you know, class struggle unions from the bottom up. So these things aren't taking place. Not to mention the largely unrecognized, although this is starting to change, the contributions of rank and file radicals who have struggled over decades to reform their unions, like the UAW, the Teamsters, to build rank and file oriented, you know, organizing centers and media projects like Labor Notes, and which runs in a fantastic conference every 2 years. This year, brought together over 30 countries, 4,500, you know, people on the front lines of class struggle attended this conference, and, you know, they had to cap registration. If they let it keep going, it would have been, you know, probably would have hit like 10,000, who's to say? And, you know, in some cases, you know, fewer though, you know, people from this generation, especially in the 60s, you know, people who were radicalized in campus struggles in the 60s, who made the turn to the industry in the 70s, you know, they've continued to be organized socialists. And, you know, this layer of people, I just want to say, we are so, so indebted to. They have carried the torch for rank and file politics and independent political action for decades. And, you know, during some of the leanest years of working class organization and politics, and they've made the revitalization of labor that we're seeing today possible. I mean, we're still a long way off from reversing our decades of decline and demobilization, but there are a lot of reasons to be cautiously optimistic, especially given the ascension of like reform movements like Unite All Workers for Democracy, Teamsters for a Democratic Union, et cetera. And then, just the, I think one thing that Daniil maybe touched on that I thought was really poignant was the division of labor between students and the labor movement. You know, I think one of the things, especially when these camps were first popping off, demonstrated to me like a really productive division of labor, in the sense that like at this moment, labor is really hamstrung by labor law, which is a very powerful ideological force, conservative politics in the labor movement, and just lack of organization in general. And so that means, like, you know, the labor movement is probably not the force in society that can get going around an issue like this. Meanwhile, students can take some more risks and, you know, start these encampments and create some fodder that radical union members can respond to. And so now that all these camps are popping up on, you know, different campuses, I, as a union member, can go to my coworkers and just be like, hey, what do you think of this? And, like, you know, it's an entry point into a conversation, and clearly much more than that, given like how many unions right now are setting up department meetings and assessing strike willingness, or not necessarily strike willingness, but willingness to take some kind of action and organize beyond resolutions. So I think that's really positive, and it brings out, like Daniil said, the catalytic role that students play, because just as students, we don't have the social power to win all our demands, but we can get other sectors of society, namely workers, inspired, and, you know, they wield much more social power. And so, yeah.
Sorry, maybe like before Amir goes, one detail I forgot to mention is that actually Cyn inspired me to think about is when, like, after October 7th, either like immediately or like in its aftermath, many unions have issued like a call for a ceasefire, like the call for like end of the bloodshed, and kind of nothing followed that statement, right? Beyond just like public statements, beyond public like public is it, public statements of, you know, union members want this, union members want to you want ceasefire, want to, you know, end the bloodshed in Gaza. Nothing would kind of followed it, and I think a lot of people on the left were scratching their heads around like, yes, like UAW called for ceasefire, I don't know, some other union called for ceasefire, a third union called for a ceasefire, but the ceasefire is not coming. Like, how do we set them in motion? And students have seemed to have done it, or I hope they did. Like, we need to like maybe see what's going to happen in the near future.
Yeah, we've really enjoyed speaking to all of you, but we'll start to wrap up. So we know it's getting late there as well, but there is so much more to talk about because this movement has spread quite quickly internationally with encampments set up on every continent, including here in Australia, where so far there are encampments set up at six universities. What opportunities do you see in building links of international solidarity between student movements?
I think if you have members of the Palestinian student body on your campus, definitely try and make inroads with them first. The important thing here is to center Palestinians, but also not leave the brunt of the work of organizing to them. Obviously, we want to, you know, not burden them with any more than you know, they can take on. Yeah. I think that's one important point that I had, and then another important thing is to and this is just about the encampments in general. This is about when you're talking about whether it's to the media or whether it's to you know, in general to other folks, you know, trying to get them to join. Definitely you want to keep in mind that this is about Gaza. You're not just here for the vibes. You're not here to party. You're not here to do what you could do on your downtime. I mean, you can, you know, survive out here, of course. You can, you know, engage with folks and engage with especially at teach-ins, engage with the material that you're, you know, that you have. But it's just really important to remember that this is for Gaza. This is something that Columbia University has also, and their encampments have also made very, very clear that this is not, you know, this is about the people of Palestine first. And so yeah, remember that. And another tip is to not litter, which we're pretty good about that so far. So far. Well, so many stuff. But you know, don't litter. It's bad for the environment. But yeah. That's what one of our leaders also said a while ago.
Yeah, so I mean, it's basic but profound. The fight for Palestine is a shared struggle. You know, our governments, especially our respective ruling classes, have a unique position in terms of the world history of carnage, pillaging, imperialism, colonialism. And so workers in our country have a historic duty to, you know, rebel at the belly of the beast. And I think the fact that this is a shared struggle is also taking on a new dimension in the sense that, you know, you mentioned that Australia now, I think, has like six encampments, and, you know, students in Australia, students in the US are increasingly tied by the fact that our methods and tactics are really unified now. And it's, you know, bringing a lot of comrades like us into contact with each other. And we have all these different opportunities to share lessons and say, you know, here's a tactic that worked for me. This was what was possible from it. This is what we could have done better. And so I think because the methods and tactics are so unified now, it's an even greater compulsion to like cross, you know, international kind of exchange. And then one other thing that I'll say is that, you know, internationalism should be, you know, a central point and the central point in, you know, any serious socialist program. And just like one connection that I really wanted to shout out is that, like, you know, a lot of comrades here in the US have been looking to Brazil because of their very diverse movement ecosystem and the fact that they have a longer unbroken tradition of organization compared to the American left, which does have a rich history, but like there's a lot of gaps in terms of connecting our generation with, say, you know, the generation of the 60s. And so we've been in contact with them because they, you know, this is like, you know, struggles like these, you know, can pop up on a year to year basis for them. And, you know, they have just so much history, and like it's part of their like daily organizing framework. Like a lot of this stuff that we're confronting right now, like how to do an effective mass meeting, that is just their second nature because they've just rinsed and repeat so much. And so, you know, we really have to look internationally to address the fact that, you know, our tradition is one that is like reformulating itself, and that there are a lot of clues that history and comrades around the world can offer us. So that's just another connection that I was thinking of.
Thanks to the three of you for taking this big chunk of time out of your obviously busy schedules at the moment to talk to us here at Green Left. It's been really informative and interesting for us to hear, and we'll obviously share this around with our networks here and with all the student encampments in Australia. And as you mentioned, it's important that we build up these international connections. So we'll wrap up the interview here, but it's been great to chat to you guys, and would love to, you know, potentially talk to you guys again in a bit more time and see how things kind of progress. And obviously sending all our kind of support and solidarity to your encampments and all the other encampments across the US and also internationally. It's a very kind of, someone said the right word isn't exciting, but maybe energizing, or it's definitely an interesting moment in the kind of Palestine solidarity movement. So thanks for talking to us.
Thank you for having us. Thank you so much. And I really want to repeat something that the member, or rather the president of the GUPS chapter here at SF State said, and it's that when it comes to Palestine and Palestinian liberation, international solidarity is so, so important. And they cannot stress that enough. I cannot stress that enough. So thank you so much for making these inroads. I look forward to seeing what y'all do in Australia. And and I'd love to talk to you y'all again once this encampment in particular has had a couple of weeks in, you know, because it's just our third day and we haven't really faced a lot of stuff. But based off of what Daniil and what Cyn were saying, you know, and also just like other encampments around the country, there's a lot that's going on. But I really, really want to thank you for having us and for listening to our perspectives. We really appreciate it, and we hope to see yours and hope to listen to yours soon.